Good morning, I'm Mike Navalio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, Typhoon Karding exits the Philippine area of responsibility, but it leaves behind a trail of destruction in the main island of Luzon.
An environmental group calls on the Philippine government to declare a climate emergency following the onslaught of Typhoon Karding.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. certifies as urgent the proposed national budget for 2023.
And South Korea and the U.S. begin their first joint naval exercise in 5 years, which North Korea warns may risk triggering a war.
Thanks for joining us. The province of Nueva Ecija declares a state of calamity due to widespread destruction caused by Typhoon Karding. Hundreds of families remain in evacuation centers as local authorities continue clearing operations. The largest damage in the province is in agriculture, Nueva Ecija serving as the rice granary of central Luzon.
Malungkot po yan. Dahil sa yung aanin, konti na lang. Unabis na marami, kumonte. Mapalit pa po tayo kaysa sa ibang lugar.
Kaya po sana kung sino po yung may mabuting loob, yung sa ating Pangulo, nais ko rin po humingi ng tulong sa kanya, hindi lang po para sa akin, kundi para na rin sa lahat ng nasalanta.
The town of Bordeos in Quezon also planning to declare a state of calamity due to the impact of Typhoon Karding. For more on the damage suffered by the entire province, we now have on the line Rainiel Pawid, reporting from the Funilio Islands. Good morning, Rainiel. What can you tell us?
Good morning, Vicky. More than 50 houses were damaged here in Funilio, Quezon Province due to Typhoon Karding. In Barangay Salipsip, residents were left with only wet clothes and broken furniture. Up to 200 hectares of crops were damaged. Even the boats were flooded and split. The local government is considering to declare a state of calamity. Nikki, in the neighboring town of Bordeos, 120 houses were partially damaged and 5 were fully damaged. Municipal government is also planning to put the town in a state of calamity. In Patnangunan, Quezon, Social Welfare Secretary Erwin Tulfo led the distribution of aid for typhoon survivors yesterday. 5,000 pesos was given to those whose houses were damaged by the typhoon, while those who totally lost their homes received 10,000 pesos plus other government assistance. Nikki?
So, Rainiel, how's the power situation there? It's also down?
Nikki, here, Nikki, in Polillo Island and in Polillo Town, yesterday at around 11 in the morning, the power supply was connected here all over the town. But in the neighboring town of Bordeos, as of 5 p.m. yesterday, the power supply is still not connected, and the linesman from the Quezelco, the power provider here in the whole Quezon province, is still under work for those electrical lines that were shattered and cut due to the winds and the heavy rain last time regarding water this town. Nikki?
What about roads rendered impassable? Are there any?
Yes, Nikki, all roads here are possible, but when we reached the place of Bordeos, there were still lots of trees and all garbages from the mudslide, and even the flood garbage are still on the road. But clearing operations is still underway, and the provincial government is also reaching to this Polillo Island. They were giving like a rescue operations of about 1,000. No, 1,000 men will be clearing all the roads, and even the relief goods packing will be centered here at the Polillo Island Municipal Hall.
All right, thanks for that update, Rainiel. You stay safe.
Karding also left thousands of families homeless in the province of Aurora, Super Typhoon Kading made its second landfall Sunday. The municipality of Dingalan says over 6,000 houses were damaged, while over 500,000 families no longer have houses to return to. The provincial government plans to help typhoon survivors through a cash for work program.
Yung mga nasiraan ng bahay ay tatrabahuhin ko nila, ayusin nila yung bahay nila. We will provide materials and then meron pa compensation po dun sa kanila.
Local officials say Karding is far worse than Typhoon Ulysses, which also hit the province in 2020 in terms of fishing boats destroyed. But the town mayor is still grateful that no life was lost.
Dahil taon-taon naman po ay talagang dinadalaw ng bagyo itong aming lugar. At isa pong paniniwala na ang pagiging handa talaga pong magiging maganda po ang resulta na maiwasan po ang pagkasawi o pagkawala ng isang buhay.
Overwhelming grief in the Philippine province of Bulacan after 5 rescuers died while trying to get people to safety during the onslaught of Typhoon Karding. The story from Katrina Domingo.
A sense of anguish enveloped the town of San Miguel as cries of grief pierced Camias village, where lifeless bodies of 5 veteran rescuers were found Monday morning. The team from the Provincial Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office was out to look for trapped residents after Typhoon Karding triggered flash floods in various parts of Bulacan. But little did they know that they will be the ones in need of saving.
Nasira yung truck nila, tapos bumaba na lang, nagbangka na lang sila para makarating dun sa sasagipin nila. Ngayon din ang nangyari nga daw ay may bumulugnos na pader. Parang sa kanila tumama, so sa lakas ng current, natangay sila.
The provincial government will be shouldering the funeral and burial or cremation fees for the rescuers who the province now hails as heroes.
Mga anak ko sila, pamilya kami sa Bulacan Rescue, kaya napakasakit. 5. Ang mahalaga, tinaas nila yung bandila ng mga rescuers na hanggang sa huli, willing nilang isacrifice yung mga sarili nila para sa dakilang layunin ng pagbibigay serbisyo sa mamamayan.
Aside from experienced rescuers, Bulacan also lost at least 3 billion pesos to agricultural damage.
Right now, pinapa-assist muna natin sa Pidrimo kung tayo magde-declare ng state of calamity. Ano po sa mga nangyayaring ito?
As of Monday afternoon, around 1,500 families or 5,000 individuals remain in evacuation centers in Bulacan, as several parts of the province are still flooded. The National Irrigation Authority explains this is due to the overflowing of the Bulon Dam, an open dam that has no retractable doors to control the flow of water. San Miguel Mayor Roderick Tiongson has announced that the suspension of classes in all levels in public and private schools in San Miguel will continue until September 27. The typhoon also triggered floods in various parts of Pampanga. In the town of Macabebe, about a dozen villages are affected. Flooded schools will have to implement blended learning for their students. In Mabalacat City, electrical sparks from a power line triggered a power outage. The ceiling of the female ward in the municipal infirmary of Candaba collapsed. Affected patients were transferred to other rooms.
Few days po, ayusin na po itong ceiling po ng community hospital.
In Zambales Province, 2 fatalities were recorded. Dozens of water buffaloes also drowned due to the floods. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. vows government aid for residents affected by Typhoon Karding. Marcos conducted aerial inspections in the storm-hit areas of Bulacan, Nueva Ecija, and Tarlaco on Monday. Prior to that, he led a briefing with government officials to assess the situation in areas devastated by the storm.
We attend to the basics, again, food, water, shelter, they need clothes, all of these things. And then the DSWD is also prepared to provide IX for them, for those that that are going to, they will need assistance. So the whole range of assistance is prepared, is ready to go. But right now, having cash is really not very useful for them. So unahin natin yung mga immediate needs nila, and then when the time comes na magagamit na nila yung AX, bibigay natin sa kanila.
But Marcos did not land in the affected areas because he does not want to disturb the local governments who are in the middle of typhoon response.
From my experience, pagka nasa local government ka, lalo na just after a typhoon, marami silang trabaho. Kung pag bumaba ako, kailangan nila ako i-welcome, kailangan yung police sa akin, kailangan kukunin ko yung mga sasakyan nila. So, ang dami nilang kailangan gawin. So, makaka-istorbo lang ako. If time will come, we'll go, we'll talk to them and see what else they need after the immediate emergency support.
Vice President Sara Duterte meanwhile condoles to families who lost loved ones during the onslaught of the typhoon. In a statement, Duterte assured the public the Marcos administration is coordinating with government agencies to provide aid to those affected.
Water service interruptions hit thousands of households Monday in the aftermath of Typhoon Pardee. Maynilad explains the storm affected the operations in some of their facilities.
Because of the high turbidity, ang epekto niyan, mas matagal inisin yung tubig dahil mas malabo. So mas kaunti din yung napoproduce ng ating planta. In effect, hindi natin napuno yung mga reservoirs at ideal levels.
As for power, Meralco said they're still restoring electricity for its nearly 36,000 customers as of Monday. That's down from Sunday's reported 1.2 million Meralco customers that were hit with power outages.
Hindi maaari na i-compromise natin, no, yung kaligtasan ng ating mga kababayan bago natin ibalik yung serbisyo ng kuryente. Alam naman natin, kapag baha, pinilit mong ibalik yan, medyo delikado. So, minamabuti na namin na ligtas lahat.
Typhoon Karding with international name Noro exited the Philippine area of responsibility on Monday night. It seemed to be picking up strength as it crosses the South China Sea towards Vietnam. The State Weather Bureau of Pagasa says Filipinos can still expect rainy weather today due to the southwest monsoon. It will bring moderate to heavy rains over Palawan and Occidental Mindoro. Meanwhile, light to moderate with at times heavy rains will be experienced over Zambales and Bataan.
In other news, President Marcos has certified as urgent the proposed spending bill for 2023. The certification was issued on September 16, stating the necessity of the budget's timely passage to maintain continuous government operations, strengthen efforts to respond more effectively to COVID pandemic, and support initiatives towards national economic recovery. It was received by the House Speaker, Martin Romualdez, on Monday. Romualdez assures the chief executive House lawmakers are on track to approve the General Appropriations Bill by Wednesday. He says because it was certified as urgent by the president, the bill can now be approved on second and third reading on the same day.
Dozens of lawmakers are seeking to reverse the proposed budget cuts to state universities and colleges next year. 30 lawmakers have signed House Resolution 403, which calls on the House Appropriations Committee to bring back the over 10 billion pesos taken from the funding for SUCs. The resolution was authored by Kabataan Party List Representative Raul Manuel, who emphasized that the budget cut will have adverse effects in the school's operations, including possible slashing of some employees. Among those with the biggest cuts to their overall budget are the University of the Philippines System, the Marikina Polytechnic University, or the Marikina Polytechnic College, rather, and the Don Mariano Marcos Memorial State University.
The Philippines' weekly COVID cases are back on an upward trend. Close to 18,000 new cases were reported on the third week of September. That's higher compared to the more than 14,000, rather, new cases recorded the week before that. Daily average cases also went up by 22%. Some 790 patients are in severe to critical condition. Officials also logged 242 deaths, mostly due to late reporting. The hospital bed utilization rate was at 27.8%, while the ICU bed occupancy rate was at 22.9%. Back to our updates on the typhoon. Karding has left at least 6 people dead in the country. And now let's talk to the spokesperson of the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council, Assistant Secretary Rafi Alejandro, for the latest situation report. Good morning, sir. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yes, good morning, Nikki, and good morning sa ating mga tagapanood, no? So our latest is that based sa ating initial assessment kahapon, no? Medyo in general, despite being a super typhoon, very minimal in terms of damages. But we are still looking at, of course, Quezon and lalo na sa Pulilio, no? Because we're still getting updates from them. But initial assessment is that medyo ang agriculture natin ang suffered most from this typhoon. Mm-hmm. So far, a report of 160 million worth of damage to agriculture has been reported by our department concerned, and close to 3,780 affected farmers and fisher folks. Mm-hmm. In terms of casualty, this morning we tallied already a total of 8, no? 5 from Bulacan, 2 from Zambales, and 1 from Quezon in Bordios. As far as evacuation is concerned, it reached a total of 45,334 persons, or close to 11,500 families, going to different evacuations in the regions affected. But as we speak, this number is already dwindling. Yung NCR po, in fact, ay nagsara na ang kanilang mga evacuation centers kahapon. So we expect more reports coming in today as we do our assessment. So yesterday we did our aerial survey together with the president, and he saw for himself yung devastation or yung damage, no, especially sa agriculture doon sa Nueva Ecija po.
Mm-hmm. And Rafi, what kind of reports did you receive yesterday and as of today?
We received reports first on the evacuation, the preparedness actions that were taken by our local government, and then the damage. We are hoping that we get reports on infrastructure, especially from Quezon. So hopefully we'll be able to get those numbers, and also on the number of houses that were affected. We hope to get that today. We have directed our regional offices in Region 3 and Region 4A to coordinate and check for themselves the reports and assess the situation on the ground personally po.
And ASEC, what areas specifically are experiencing problems in communication lines, power outages as we speak?
Yeah, in terms of communication, the minimal lang po, no? Areas that experience without signal or communication. But in for power, we have reports as far as Quezon, Tarlac, and Nueva Ecija experiencing power interruption. This is mainly because of precautionary measure also undertaken by our cooperatives, no? Before they energize these areas, they have to ensure that the power lines are okay or are not damaged to ensure na wala pong ma-aksidente when they energize these power lines po.
And is there any modes of transportation po that have since been suspended, areas currently impassable right now?
Yeah, as of yesterday, nung nagtanggal na tayo ng signal and the gale warnings were removed, no, by PAGASA, nag-resume na rin yung mga travels natin or operations ng mga ports natin that were affected. But as of yesterday, 47 seaports were non-operational. But today, we expect these ports to be operational. And the tally that we got is that there were some 2,737 stranded passengers in Mimaropa, Calabarzon, and Region 5.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned earlier when you're still waiting on some reports on infrastructure damage, but what reports have you received so far?
So far, we received a formal or official report from the Department of Agriculture. The DA, the DPWH is still doing their assessment, and we hope to come up with their assessment and the figures, no, to the extent and cost of damage on infrastructure. But as I said, we expect a very minimal as far as infrastructure is concerned, but more on the agriculture side.
Mm-hmm. And let's go back to how evacuation centers are doing. Are the nations constantly making their way there to the areas affected?
Yes, for the nations, we have not monitored any, no. But for government assistance, tuloy-tuloy po ito, especially those coming from DSWD, because we have put on standby close to 200 family packs, 200,000 family food packs on standby, and these are always ready, no, to augment yung resources ng ating mga local government units.
Mm-hmm. And what of relief operations for other relief goods bound for different parts of the country,
yeah,
especially those not affected?
Yes, our regional office in Calabarzon has organized a relief operation specifically for Pulilio Island. And I believe as we speak, they are on their way there. They will be using Black Hawk helicopters, no, to bring in supplies and people to the island po.
Mm-hmm. And we know very well, sir, that there have been casualties to this super typhoon. Have you reached out to other organizations for help concerning not only relief but also rescue efforts?
Yeah, we have received offers of assistance even from ASEAN neighbors, no, offering assistance for search and rescue, for assessment. And we told them that this event is very manageable, and in the event that they will be giving materials, no, relief goods, we welcome them as well, mm-hmm, as long as they are already available inside the country.
And sir, lastly, before we let you go, right now, what are you most in need of? Giving you this opportunity to appeal for help to our viewers who may wish to donate or may volunteer.
Yeah, based on our assessment here at the central office, most of the needs will be in a form of housing assistance, especially for those affected in Quezon, in Pulilio Islands, because we have seen houses, mostly made of light materials, have been heavily affected. So in terms of food, kasi we're okay with that, but we can extend assistance maybe in a form of shelter, no, shelter assistance or shelter materials.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Asek Rafi, you stay safe.
Yes, thank you very much and good morning to you.
Now here's a look at other stories we're tracking today. We will continue to bring you updates on the impact of Typhoon Panding in Luzon.
And at 9 a.m., the commission on appointments will convene to discuss the ad interim appointment of Conrado Estrella III as Agrarian Reform Secretary. Lady Vicentia will monitor that story.
And House lawmakers resume budget plenary deliberations. On their agenda today, the budgets of the Interior, Transportation, Energy, and Environment Departments. RG Cruz and Vivian Gulia will keep tabs on those hearings.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, environmental group Aksyon Klima urges the Marcos administration to ramp up the government's climate action in the wake of Typhoon Karding. We'll be speaking with Aksyon Klima convener Rodney Galicia.
And South Korea and the U.S. begin their first joint naval exercise in 5 years, which North Korea warns may risk triggering a war. These and more with the Rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web, Inquirer's banner story online, the former chief of the Philippine Sugar Regulatory Administration to be detained for 15 days after being cited for contempt by a Negros Occidental court. Philippine Star's top story, the Office of the Press Secretary puts on hold its plan to accredit bloggers to cover Malacanang. Manila Bulletin's headline, the Education Department reminds storm-hit local governments, public schools may only be used as evacuation centers for a maximum of 15 days. And topping GMA News' website, the Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board has allowed standing passengers inside some public utility vehicles in areas placed under COVID Alert Level 1.
The Philippines was spared of the worst of the storm thanks to the Sierra Madre mountain range. ABS-CBN News' resident meteorologist Ariel Lojas said the typhoon significantly weakened after it hit the country's longest mountain range. Rojas adds, Karding's speed also helped lessen its destructive impact.
actually nung pagkatawid niya sa may Sierra Madre na sa may Nueva Ecija area, yeah, parang medyo lumiit yung blob na red.
Yung rain band niya.
Yes, kung saan concentrated yung malalakas na mga pag-ulan.
The country also marked the Save Sierra Madre Day on Monday. The presidential proclamation made in 2012 calls for awareness and public participation in helping conserve the mountain range.
And as threats of national disasters persist, the Asian Development Bank is providing emergency financing to member countries. The ADB acknowledges the plight of some developing countries, which sometimes deal with extreme weather events. It says such incidents are making food and energy security more difficult to achieve.
In long term, we are reviewing now our project in our pipeline for DMCs to see how we can support our DMCs to build very strong, robust, and sustainable food systems through climate smart agriculture, digitalization of food value chain, and nature-based solutions.
An environmental group calls on the Philippine government to declare a climate emergency following the onslaught of Typhoon Karting. Action Klima also wants the loss and damage incurred from the storm to be part of the agenda in the COP27 climate talks in Egypt this November. For more on this, joining us now is Action Klima Pilipinas convener Rodney Galicia. Rodney, good morning. Welcome to the program.
Hi, good morning. Good morning to everyone. And we hope that everyone is safe after the onslaught of Typhoon Karting.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Rodney, one peculiar aspect of Typhoon Karting is that it quickly intensified into a super typhoon in a matter of hours. The public has just been introduced to the concept of rapid intensification. And no less the president said, we have never seen this before. So let me ask you the same question he asked. Yan na ba yung climate change?
There are so many factors affecting the typhoons, no? And we've seen this in Typhoon Yolanda before because of the intensified heat and in the Pacific Ocean. We know that almost 94% of the heat is being absorbed by the ocean, and such actually affects the processes when it comes to the intensification of typhoons. As we all know, the Philippines, we have 20 to 25 typhoons per year. But before we got the signal number 1, 2, and 3. And after that, for the last 10, 15 years, now we developed not only signal number 4, but signal number 5. So that means that because of the inconsistencies in climate patterns, intensities of typhoons are getting higher and higher. And we never see this before. But saying that this only happened like during Typhoon Karting. No, it did not. In the last how many years, we've seen already intensification of typhoons.
Mm-hmm. And Rodney, that many people have to ask this question, it's not just the president, to be fair. Is that an indication of the level of awareness of the public of the effects of climate change? A UN climate change report last year already warned that global warming is dangerously close to spiraling out of control. So how do we explain this to the public to make it simple, easy to understand, and make it relevant to their daily lives?
Yes. In simple terms. Filipinos, the emission, carbon emission of Filipinos is very, very small. It's almost 0.4% of the total. And the losses and damages that we experience, specifically for Typhoon Yolanda, that will explain how serious this issue is. But at the same time, it is at the level of demanding from larger countries who are responsible to larger emissions, and so who are responsible to, you know, their biggest industrialization since, of course, the Industrial Revolution have actually affected a lot of patterns and natural processes. And that not only that, when we talk about the climate crisis, it's not only about emissions, not only about actually intensification of climate of typhoons, is also how we see development, because there are so many development strategies, not only of the government, not only of the Philippines, but the whole world, that will intensify also the effects of the climate crisis. So at the end of the day, this should actually be discussed by nations at the United Nations, because recently it is so difficult to put losses and damages issues and cases in the following conference of parties, specifically in Egypt, because the larger countries would see that as a burden for them. But for us, it must be demanded not only the historical losses and damages, calculate it, the value of it, but only the precedent of the future.
Mm-hmm. Now, the president did mention that climate change in his UNGA speech, but how do you reconcile his question yesterday asking if this is climate change? Was that really an honest question because he genuinely wanted to know if that was the effect of climate change, or was he merely making a point to the public? Given that, of course, in that UN General Assembly speech, climate change was a big part of that speech.
I think when we look at the narrative, so many times during his oath taking and even during the SONA, State of the Nation address, and the United Nations General Assembly statement, I believe the president is just only making a point, making a point that this is happening. And this is, but you know, for the first, I mean, for less than a month, we experienced 3 super typhoons, the intensification of it. And at the same time, as you've said, in just an hour, it intensified to super typhoon signal number 5. So I believe the president is making a point, and we hope that with his words at the United Nations General Assembly, he will take it seriously. And even if he wishes to go to the Conference of Parties in Egypt, that would be, of course, will be happy. And so he will be able to make a point, not only for the Philippines, but also for other countries who are most vulnerable to the climate crisis.
And talk about that UNGA speech. The president said climate change is the greatest threat affecting various nations. He also touched on historical injustice, how those who are least responsible, like the Philippines, suffer more. Were you encouraged that the president specifically mentioned that in his speech?
Yes, of course. And we've been fighting for climate justice. And for us, climate justice is actually making sigil, no, of the historical debt of other nations. And as we all know, more than 10,000 lives and livelihoods have been lost, and we cannot afford any more losses and damages. And though we are not responsible for those greater emissions, these countries are responsible, and we make them accountable through loss and damage mechanism. You know, we call this WASO international mechanism. We'll be able to actually make them accountable, and of course, influence them, force them if necessary, in diplomatic terms, no, to actually sit down with us. And instead of us asking for loans, we need to have more grants, and through diplomacy and through, you know, demanding climate justice, then we can actually make something out of this loss and damage mechanism towards sustainable financing for our adaptation and mitigation strategies, specifically for the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. Rodney, you talked about that mechanism to assess possible liability, but how feasible is that to actually implement that system? And how can we accurately tell or accurately measure or quantify the impact of climate change in a particular country?
There is a working group already, and that's in the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. This working group is the JAGO Network, no, for loss and damages, are tasked to think, no, and to sit down on how the mechanism would be implemented. But I think when we talk about the Philippines, declaring climate emergency would be a big help, not only for LGUs, but the national level, institutionalize it as a law, because at the end of the day, if we have that institutionalization of climate emergency, and that includes actually loss and damages, the national determined contribution, then we have that document, no? And even actually asking other nations to do so. So if that will be part of the law of the land, then we can lobby. At the level of the United Nations that indeed liabilities and help, financial assistance would be, of course, be given to countries like the Philippines. It's a long dialogue, no, and even at the level of deciding whether to put that on the agenda, in the agenda, we need more people. And actually, the civil society organizations for quite so long have been helping the government to talk to other nations, to talk to our counterparts in other countries. For them also to influence their own governments to, you know, to decide on these important matters. And we hope that the non-government organizations and other sectors will be included in the series of consultations. And the Climate Change Commission has been very, very open for the last 3-4 months for the civil society and even other sectors to sit down together on how to strategize to, you know, to influence platform, United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, and even the presidency in Egypt for COP27, you know, to put that in the agenda.
Mm-hmm. Before we talk about the declaration of climate emergency, let me go back to that suggestion of coming up with a law that will impose compensation for loss and damage due to climate change. How can we enforce that on other countries, Rodney? Have you seen any way that this has been, or any previous incident that this has been effectively enforced, a country forced to pay for the damage to another country due to climate change?
Recently, we have Denmark already. Denmark already committing to do some kind of financing and assistance to countries affected by the climate crisis, specifically those who have experienced losses and damages. We know also that Scotland, before during COP26, has already committed to help. As I have said, it will be actually not really a difficult process, but it's a matter of persuasion. It's also a matter of sitting down together, not only in the halls of COP27, but also in the sidelines, because as we always say, real negotiations happen during coffee breaks, happen during dinners, and during meals. We hope that with the help of not only of the government, but other sectors, will be able to convince bigger countries to do so.
Lastly, and very quickly, how will the declaration of climate emergency help all these?
The declaration of climate emergency will actually give roadmap and even policy track or policy reform when it comes to development. The Congress has already approved the General Appropriations Act, but having a climate emergency law, which will also amend the Climate Change Act of 2009 as amended with the People's Survival Fund, this will bigger influence on our development track, on our investment plans, among others, to be serious enough and be required, to tag and even propose projects, programs, and activities that are climate screened. Meaning to say, if we see that the climate crisis is a real threat, then it can be policy track influence, you know, all our strategies and even the Philippine Development Plan. So,
all right.
The CAA has some provisions actually, but it is only effective for a year. But if we have a law which will be a basis for policy reform, then and enabling laws and resolutions, then it should be necessary. We can also bring that to the United Nations as well.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Rodney Galicia, convener of Aksyon Klima.
Thank you, Mike. Good day.
Let's now get an update on the situation in storm-hit Bulacan from our correspondent, Katrina Domingo. Good morning, Kat.
Hi, good morning, Mike. The sun is already shining here in Bulacan, one of the provinces devastated by Typhoon Karding over the weekend and yesterday morning. However, despite the sunny ambiance here, the mood, particularly in this home where I'm standing, is very somber as the family and relatives and friends of George Agustin continue to mourn his untimely demise. Agustin is one of the 5 rescuers whose bodies were found dead yesterday morning in the town of San Agustin. Officials say that they have drowned, but investigators
are still confirming if they were also electrocuted after their boat capsized at the height of Typhoon Kerding over the weekend. Mike, we spoke to Agustin's widow, Eka, and she is very devastated by her husband's death. She questions the decision of the government, of the provincial government, to deploy the rescue team to San Miguel Town at the height of the typhoon. She says they could have waited for the worst to pass before asking their rescue teams to go around the villages in search of residents who may be trapped in their homes. But more than her frustration against the provincial government or the superiors of Agustin, Agustin's widow is more angered by the residents who refuse to leave their homes ahead of time. She says if not for their stubbornness, if not for their refusal to comply to government warnings, then her husband would have still been alive and her children, her three children, would have not been fatherless as of the moment. So far, Mike, we are still waiting for the announcement of the provincial government of Bulacan on whether or not they will declare a state of calamity following this devastation. Mike.
Kat, just one question. Really a heartbreaking story. And you now have the widow blaming those who refuse to evacuate. What did the local government say about this? Will they be implementing new measures in the coming calamities to ensure that no rescuer would be unnecessarily placed in danger because of those who refuse to evacuate?
No word on that yet, Mike, because as we all know, time and time again, typhoons are not a new thing to the Philippines. We have been enduring this natural calamity, this natural phenomenon for decades already, and yet Filipinos, again and again, time and time, over and over, would still refuse to heed the government's call to leave their homes and to ensure that their lives would be safe first before looking after their properties. So no word yet, Mike, on whether or not local authorities or the local government would actually push their constituents to at least have some personal reforms in order to save more lives, particularly that of rescuers. Mike.
Thank you so much for that update. Katrina Domingo, live from Bulacan.
Another grim outlook for the global economy. The Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, or OECD, says global growth is slowing faster than was forecast months ago as energy and inflation rose, risks snowballing into recessions. While global growth is still expected at 3% this year, it's projected to slow to 2.2% in 2023. That's down from a June forecast of a 2.8% expansion. The OECD is particularly pessimistic for Europe, the most directly exposed economy to Russia's war in Ukraine. It sees Germany's economy contracting next year due to its dependence on Russian gas. Though far less dependent on imported energy than Europe, the U.S. was seen skidding into a downturn as the Federal Reserve jacks up interest rates to get a handle on inflation. Meanwhile, the OECD says China's strict COVID measures may limit its economic growth to only 3.2% this year.
The International Monetary Fund is slashing its growth forecast for the Philippines. It sees the local economy growing 6.5% this year. That's weaker than the IMF's previous 6.7% forecast, but still within government's growth target of 6.5 to 7.5%. A further slowdown is seen in 2023 with growth hitting just 5%. The IMF says slower growth in the country's major trade partners, namely China and the U.S., will affect the Philippines. A slowdown next year is attributed to the effects of the Philippine Central Bank's monetary policy tightening to fight elevated inflation. Speaking of inflation, the IMF sees the consumer price index in the country hitting 5.3% this year before declining modestly in 2023.
A look now at the financial markets. The global sell-off continues with Wall Street hitting new lows at the start of the week. The Dow slipped into bear market territory Monday after falling 1.1%. The S&P 500 reached a new low for the year at 36.55, while the Nasdaq lost 0.6%. Steady losses have been plaguing Wall Street for weeks amid fears the Federal Reserve's aggressive monetary policy tightening could throw the U.S. economy into a recession. And over in Europe, markets also closed lower as investors continue to weigh a deteriorating economic outlook for the region. And here in Asia, stocks resumed their slide as negative sentiment continues to dominate the markets. Japan's Nikkei 225 was among the underperformers. The PSE was closed due to tightening cutting.
Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring this Tuesday. The Philippines will post its budget balance for August. The country's budget deficit narrowed to 86.8 billion pesos in July from 215.5 billion pesos in June, as revenues posted a double-digit growth while expenditures only rose by nearly 5%. Mexico will come out with its August jobs figures. The unemployment rate in Mexico fell to 3.4% in July, beating market expectations and reflecting the growth in the domestic economy. And the U.S. will report new home sales numbers for the month of August. Sales of new single-family houses in the U.S. plunged 12.6% to 511,000 in July, the lowest reading since January 2016, amid rising borrowing costs, prices, and a fall in demand.
A warning from North Korea as South Korea and the U.S. begin their first joint naval exercise in 5 years. Pyongyang's ambassador to the United Nations called the drills a dangerous act that could bring the Korean Peninsula to the brink of war. The joint drills come a day after nuclear-armed North Korea conducted another ballistic missile launch, the latest in its record-breaking blitz of weapon tests this year. Earlier this month, the North revised its nuclear weapons law, allowing it to carry out a preventive nuclear strike immediately to destroy what it called hostile forces.
Over in Japan, security forces on high alert ahead of the controversial state funeral of slain former Prime Minister Shinzo Abe today, Tuesday. Thousands of police officers have been deployed across Tokyo amid public anger over the use of public funds for $11 million event. Thousands have been holding protests in the capital since last week, demanding the state funeral be called off. The ceremony will begin at 2 in the afternoon, Tokyo time. Dozens of foreign dignitaries are expected to attend. For the Philippines, it will be Vice President Sara Duterte, who earlier said she is bringing condolence letters from her father, former President Rodrigo Duterte, and from President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.
A school shooting rocks Russia with 13 people dead, including 7 children. 14 other minors and 7 adults were also wounded. Authorities say the gunman, who was said to be wearing clothes with Nazi symbols, committed suicide. Russian President Vladimir Putin has denounced the shooting, describing it as an inhuman terrorist attack.
Congratulatory messages pour in for Giorgia Meloni, who is on course to become Italy's first ever female prime minister. British Prime Minister Liz Truss congratulated Meloni on the victory of her party, the far-right Brothers of Italy. Secretary of State Antony Blinken, meanwhile, says America is eager to work with Italy's new government. The win of the Brothers of Italy party marks a seismic change in Italy, as Meloni is expected to lead the most right-wing government in the country since World War II. Meloni, a former teen activist who has railed against the European Union, vowed to govern for all Italians in her first public statement since Sunday's elections.
China's envoy to Manila says Beijing is committed to preserving its friendship with the Philippines. That remark made by Ambassador Huang Xilian in an online reception marking China's 73rd founding anniversary. He said Beijing wants to boost cooperation with Manila in agriculture, energy, and infrastructure. He also stressed the need to deepen mutual trust and increase communication on bilateral and regional issues. Huang's comments followed remarks by Philippine President Marcos Jr., who said in an interview that Manila has no territorial dispute with China. But the president noted in the same interview that China is claiming territory that belongs to the Philippines. Marcos recently spoke with U.S. President Joe Biden in New York about Beijing's expansive claims in the South China Sea.
We should properly handle differences to remove interference from China-Philippine relations. We are neighbors that cannot be moved away and have every reason to live together peacefully. We should put our differences in a proper place and seek peaceful solutions through friendly consultations, so that our overall relations will not be affected.
The Philippine Justice Department orders the closure of 175 Philippine offshore gaming operators, or POGOs. The licenses have been canceled due to their alleged criminal activities. Some 280 Chinese nationals who work for the POGOs are now under custody. Justice officials say more than 40,000 Chinese nationals working in the POGO industry are set to be deported in batches. The Justice Department is coordinating with the Chinese embassy to begin the deportation process in October.
In entertainment, the controversial film Don't Worry Darling hits the big screen. Our resident movie critic, Manny the Movie Guy, tells us what he thinks about the star-studded flick.
Haunting, intriguing, and highly controversial. The sci-fi drama Don't Worry Darling from director Olivia Wilde is now out for you to enjoy or hate. It's a polarizing film preceded by its reputation.
Yumi.
Indeed, with all the real-life drama surrounding production, it may be hard to see this movie without any preconceived notion. Pro tip, leave your worries behind and be seduced by the movie, at least until the last part. Can't you see? Partly shot in Palm Springs, the desert serves as a beautiful but arid backdrop with the iconic Kaufman House serving as one of the characters.
We men, we ask a lot.
Inside this mid-century modern home is a seemingly perfect marriage. The wife, Alice, is happy doing chores every day and making her husband, Jack, happy at night.
Discretion above all else.
The always fantastic Florence Pugh is front and center as the wife. She suspects that not all is what it seems. She notices something weird in this idealistic utopian existence. Of course, her husband, played dutifully by pop star Harry Styles, does not agree.
Sleep in the bedroom.
The supporting cast is also good, with Wilde appearing on camera as Alice's best friend Bunny, and Chris Pine is Jack's boss.
Nasty word.
The film, like its production, has many secrets. You'll spend the first half trying to figure it all out, then find yourself checking time because of its lumbering second half. Wilde, who gave us the super funny Booksmart, one of my favorite films of 2019, tried her best to make sense of the overstuffed script. Her great cast, including herself, surely helped, even though some of my expectations were not met.
I have some pills I can prescribe for that.
In the end, this hodgepodge of Stafford Wives and Inception is a hollow but watchable exercise on gender oppression. It's ably directed and acted with cunning use of sound and images. You may be able to predict the outcome long before the film catches up, but this, I tell you, don't worry about the film, darlings. It's just fine. And for that, Don't Worry Darling gets 3 out of 4. Take us back to the good old days. Kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.